By his own account, Holocaust survivor Bill Morgan has lived four lives under four different names. From the time he was a boy, Bill wrestled with hatred and anti-Semitism, and through many encounters was forced to question his own identity and reinvent himself at every crossroad. Against all odds, Bill found the courage and resilience to overcome profound suffering and personal tragedy. As the sole survivor of not only his large family, but also 100 other Jewish families in his village, Bill made a promise to himself and to the blessed memory of his loved ones that he would somehow rise above the darkness and persevere. What becomes clear through his story is that hard work, faith, determination, and love ultimately triumph over evil. This is the story of Bill Morgan and his four lives. Bill Morgan's first life began on May 18, 1925, in the small farming village of Czerniejów in southeastern Poland. He was born Jasula Margulies. Jasula's parents, Yitzhak and Ethel Margulies, were deeply religious Orthodox Jews. In 1941, at the age of 16, the Germans invaded Jasula's village and marched all of the Jews to a ghetto, while the local Ukrainians applauded. During the march, unaware of where they were going, Bill's younger brother asked his mother, "Where are we going? Why are we going? I want to go home." Bill's father then said, "With God's help, we'll be back tomorrow." That tomorrow never came. After walking for hours, they arrived at the ghetto, hungry and tired. Over time, many would meet their fates of being shot at random or succumbing to illness or starvation. Eventually, everyone was ordered to register for work, and Jasula, fortunate to have farming skills, registered as a farmhand. Jasula was sent to work on a farm outside the ghetto during the day, returning at night with meager portions of food hidden in his clothing to give his family. While on the farm, Jasula became friends with one of the local Christian kids. His name was Stefan Chesnovsky. One day, while walking to work, Jasula was picked up in a truck and forced by the Nazis to dig holes in a nearby graveyard, only to learn they were digging graves for their fellow Jews. Truckload after truckload of innocent men, women, and children were brought to the gravesite, brutally shot, and left to die. Carefully hiding behind a gravestone until dark, and horrified by what he had witnessed, Jasula decided the moment had finally come to flee. When he told his parents of his plans, his mother said, "If you run away and don't bring us food, we will starve." But his father, who was very weak, gave him his blessing in Hebrew, saying, "Son, if you survive, we'll meet in heaven, and you will tell me all about it." After convincing his Christian friend Stefan to sell him his birth certificate as a means to escape, Jasula dug under the electrified fence surrounding the ghetto and emerged into his second life as Stefan Chesnovsky. Stefan boarded a train heading east into the Ukraine and the unknown. He would spend the next 4 years laboring in the village of Yazana, finding jobs on family farms in exchange for meals and a place to sleep. Thoughts of his parents and siblings tormented him. Guilt for escaping, questions of what may have happened to them, and if he would ever see them again. He would later learn that he was the only survivor of the Margulies family, and that all the Jews from his entire village had been wiped out. In 1944, the Russians forcefully drafted all able-bodied men to fight the Germans, Stefan among them. During basic training, Stefan learned to drive a truck. When his military unit was sent back to serve in Poland, fearing the volatile political situation, Stefan ran away. Numb, alone, and almost 20 years old, Stefan used his new skill and found work as a truck driver. He desperately wanted to return home to Chernihiv and try to find family members, but Stefan's friends told him it was too dangerous to go back and arranged for him to cross the border into Germany, where a displaced persons camp was being set up. Having survived the war years in Poland with a Polish name, Stefan felt that starting over with a German name would be safer. So he called himself Willy Weisberg and thus began his third life. In the fall of 1945, Willy crossed the border into Germany and arrived in Regensburg, where the Red Cross assigned him a room with a German family. After the war, he spent years searching for any sign of his family, only to find that no one had survived. Each day, he would go to the Jewish Community Center and try to find out any information about his missing loved ones. After hearing details of the misery and unspeakable atrocities in the camps, a new sense of guilt plagued Willy. He wondered why he had survived, yet his entire family had perished. Lonely and miserable, Willy realized he had nothing left to live for in Europe and wanted the chance to start a new life. He spent the next 4 years living and working in Germany while waiting for sponsorship and the hope of emigrating to the United States. That chance finally came in the summer of 1949. Willy arrived at the New York City harbor at night, passing by the Statue of Liberty, a symbol of freedom for the poor and the downtrodden. With only a few dollars in his pocket and wondering how he could possibly make a new life for himself, he thought of his father's final blessing and knew he must fulfill the promise to carry on. 2 days later, Willy was on a train from New York to Cedar Rapids, Iowa, where a local businessman had sponsored him to travel there and work in his shoe store. When he arrived at the train station, he was met by his new boss, Sam Cohen, and given a clean room at the YMCA. Willy knew very little English, but despite the solitude, the language barrier, and his anxiety at what might lie ahead, for the first time since he was a young boy, Willy felt hopeful. He worked around the clock and was able to start saving small amounts of money. He had become Sam's best salesman, and after only 6 months in Cedar Rapids, Sam promoted Willy to manager of his shoe store in Kansas City, Missouri. With the help of Sam and his new friend Skinny, the kind black man who shined shoes in the back of the store, Willy slowly learned the new language. He would go to night school and would also spend endless hours watching Roy Rogers movies. After some time, Willy made plans to go to Texas, so he bought his first car and with his meager possessions, he headed west. While detouring south in an attempt to meet his hero, Roy Rogers, Willie's car broke down in Houston, Texas. With little money to continue his journey, he decided to stay put for a while. He got a job right away selling shoes at a downtown store, and he was doing well, but felt the only way to really succeed was to have a business of his own. It was 1952, and Willy, now going by the name Bill, was able to negotiate the purchase of a small cafe in downtown Houston, and he was in business. On the 1st of January, 1953, he legally changed his name to the very American-sounding William Jacob Morgan. William for Wolf, his birth name, Morgan for Margulies, his family name, and the middle name Jacob, a common Jewish name, to quietly remind himself that he was a Jew. In his fourth life, Bill Morgan, now 28 years old, was an American entrepreneur in the making. After a year in business, he sold the cafe at a profit. Engaging in a variety of other endeavors, including the wholesale meat business, he worked day and night, gaining more and more confidence as a businessman. Although Bill still questioned his Jewishness in the aftermath of the war, after years of living in the United States and witnessing the freedom and vitality of the American Jewish life, his faith in Judaism slowly began to resurface. Yet something was still missing. While renting a room in the home of a Jewish family, Bill realized the time had come to focus on finding a wife and starting his own family. It was then that he met Shirley, a beautiful Sephardic Jewish girl who lived next door. She believed in him and his ambition, and he finally felt a sense of purpose and happiness. So in 1954, Bill and Shirley married and began their new life together. After the birth of their two sons, Ronnie and Michael, and modest success in the meat business, Bill decided to construct a building in order to expand the business. By 1960, after their daughter Mindy was born, he sold the meat business at a profit and founded a new real estate company called Globe Construction, along with a property management subsidiary, Globe Management. His fourth child, Wendy, was born in 1964. And in 1968, his fifth, Scott completed the Morgan family. With pride in the birth of each child, Bill silently yearned for the family he lost and vowed to protect and work tirelessly for the new legacy he created. Growing his company and raising his five children were Bill's absolute priorities. Tantamount to strong family values was his natural drive and hands-on attention to detail. In 1979, Bill asked Michael, Ronnie, and Scott to join his company and renamed it the Morgan Group Incorporated. The business thrived and over the years expanded into the multi-million dollar real estate and construction company it is today. Having accomplished everything he set out to achieve, Bill then decided to dedicate his energy to keeping the memory of the Margulies family alive. In 1997, he self-published a book titled Living Longer Than Hate and played a fundamental role in establishing Holocaust Museum Houston. He raised funds for its development, established a meaningful memorial to his family, and his company helped build the museum, which he continues to generously support. He commonly speaks at the museum about his experiences. From Poland to Russia, Germany to America, Yusula fulfilled the promises made from his tiny village so long ago. At every opportunity, he teaches the vital lessons of the Holocaust by spreading messages of love, tolerance, and respect. In addition to serving on the boards of several organizations, he is now a consultant to the family business and still goes to the office every day. From his pleasing corner office, his eyes proudly navigate the walls of pictures of his wife, five children, and 14 grandchildren. William Jacob Morgan can finally sit back and without guilt enjoy his legacy and smile peacefully at the beautiful treasures life has given him.